We have to be everywhere. So it's not just about us prospecting. You know, you think about prospecting in its traditional meaning, you know, pick an axe out there, hard work, looking for gold. All that is changing. We have to put ourselves out there so that buyers can find us. We have to stop thinking about what our unique selling proposition is and instead start thinking about what problems that we solve. Because the way the buying process is working in North America these days is that buyers, the people who are in charge of spending money with you, are going into Google or Bing or Chrome or whatever their, you know, favorite web browser search engine is, and they're typing in questions, typing in problems. Even last night, I was trying to make something on Amazon, on my Kindle, and I couldn't figure out how to change the credit card on the one click. Does anyone have a Kindle or an iPad? Okay, you know when you buy a book, it's one click, and it was going to a credit card that I didn't know where that credit card was, and I had no idea how I was paying for this thing. And I was trying to figure out how to change it, and the Amazon site gave me no help, and I had to Google, how do I change the credit card in the Kindle one click? It's a problem, and all the websites that provide help come up. And that's what you need to do. What are the problems that your customers are having? And this is a transformation for a lot of companies because I still get called into sales rallies where they have breakouts on let's create our elevator pitch, let's create our unique selling proposition in isolation of the problems that our market is having. It's useless and it's a complete waste of your time. So only focus on the problems. In the past, we used to really talk about how many calls I can make. Now we need to talk about how many calls can I return and how fast. Now here's a heartbreaking story. And I told this to a group the other day. This to me, as a sales professional and a business owner, is heart-wrenching. And it's a true story. One of our subsidiary businesses is a company called Testimonial Director. It's a little software company that we have. And we've been rolling out this software for a couple of years now, and we're going to our first big trade show. And my husband, who's my business partner, who runs that side of the business, Chris, needs to buy a trade show booth. So we're at a little show a few months ago. He sees a booth that he likes. He gets a referral to the trade show company from this guy. They say, call this company. They're great. We love them. So Chris calls them. Or actually, he emails them because he didn't have a phone number. And he types into the contact us, this is who I am. I own a business. We're going to a show on June 11th. We need a trade show booth. Please call us. It was 10 days ago. No response. So we started to think, this is kind of interesting. Maybe we should test some companies. Well, we're back in Ottawa. Let's test some Ottawa companies. And without naming names, we reached out to four locally based trade show exhibit design companies in this city with that exact message on, Casey, where are you? What day was that? Do you remember? It was last week. Today is what day? Tuesday. It was Wednesday or Thursday of last week. One has been in touch with us. So I certainly hope those other three companies are absolutely bringing in profits like you can't imagine. But if I owned the business and found out that people were coming to me with clear messages, I own a business, I'm going to a trade show, you have stuff I need, I have a deadline, and my salespeople weren't calling. 4 days later, I'd be livid. And so we need to be focused on that. 24 hours maximum. In fact, what we're finding is that if people are actively searching for solutions to problems that you have, and your salespeople can be responsive inside of a two-hour mark, you have a massive increase or a massive advantage in winning that business from your clients. So we need to be focused on how are we going to return those calls. We also need to be looking at multiple types of media. So it's not just about the phone, the email, or the mail anymore. It's really about meeting your client where they're at. What technologies do they want to use? And that's the most important thing. It's not just about the technologies you want to use. I do business, a lot of business in the agriculture industry with the big agriculture manufacturers. And one of my clients is young. He's just barely 30 years old. He has large budgets, 5-6-figure budgets for his marketing programs. And you might think this is really crazy, but he and I do all of our negotiation and contract approvals through text message. Now, text message to you, and maybe even to me, might not really seem like a good way to do business. You're thinking, well, I want to talk to the customer. I'd like to see the customer. But he controls budgets of $30,000, $50,000, $100,000 and has signing authority. And the easiest way for him to communicate with his suppliers is through text message. I would rather have that $50,000 than be right about wanting to meet him in person. It's just me. So I don't fight him. He wants a text message, I'll send him a text message. So it's not about using the technologies that you're comfortable with. It's about embracing the technologies that your client is comfortable with and using that media effectively. Whatever that is in your marketplace, don't try to force the customer to do business your way. That's one of the biggest stumbling blocks that I see with organizations trying to sell, is they get so focused on their sales process, their order entry process, their internal processes, that they forget that our job is to meet the buyer and create a situation in which people want to buy from us, right? And lastly, it used to be as salespeople, now of course we probably never used those words because they seem a little bit client repellent, but our goal was to go out and try to build trust. But in today's marketplace, that's not so easy. People want proof. And two things are happening. They're either asking for proof or they're looking for proof before they engage with you. And over and over and over again, what we're seeing in the marketplace is that buyers are trying to prove that you're worthy of doing business with them, you're sales worthy, you're buyer worthy, before they pick up the phone and call you. So they have a trust in you before you actually engage. And they want to talk to other people, either on their own, they want to do independent research on you before they choose whether it's worth their time to actually spend 5, 10, 15 minutes talking to you. And so that proof is really critical. I'm going to show you some statistics in a minute they really surprised me. But if you could do one thing differently in all of the marketing material that you had out there, my suggestion would be that you get rid of all the corporate speak and you replace it with all customer testimonials, because that's what people are interested in. They don't believe really what we say about ourselves, because they say, oh, of course, you say it's great, you wrote it. In fact, some studies show that only 6% of people that come to your website believe what you wrote about yourself. Yet upwards of 87% of people believe the client testimonials. And that's not because they think you're lying about yourself, but they know that you wrote it, right? It's corporate speak.